friends. Welcome back to episode 6 of Bincotton Bridge with me, your host, Oyster Boy. So I've been studying our little community, and I have decided that if we want to look to expanding production, you know, getting a tavern going, things like that, we really need to get a boost in our population. studying the graphs here of, population, we can see that the adults have taken a big dip here. This was the Great Dying. And the children is on a sort of a slow uptick, but I think we want to make this rise up a little bit faster, because we're going to need a surge of laborers in order to fill these new jobs. We do have 5 students. 5 laborers would be great, but we're going to need more than 5. So I've decided to add 3 more houses all at once, bang, 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 and we're playing at speed 1. That's why everybody seems to be just crawling along here, and people are presently delivering items to the homes to be built. I knocked my vendor down by 1 and my trader down by 1 because I only had 1 laborer and we're going to need builders to put this up. So let's skip ahead to speed 10. Let them get these houses built. Alright, we just lost our woodcutter. She died of old age and there was no one available to replace her. So I'm going to drop a forester and raise the woodcutter. Alright, let's release that. Okay. Is there a production graph? There's a food graph. I got that at least. Okay. 1 house just came online. People should move into these houses relatively quickly. 2nd house came online. Alright, now that's interesting. Nobody's moving into the 2nd house. Maybe we don't have enough young families. Alright, well, better to have the house than not to have the house. I don't think a house that's empty consumes anything. Yeah, the inventory's empty. So we'll have a couple of extra houses. That shouldn't hurt anything. This house filled right up. Oh, I thought it said it had filled up. Well, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe no one moved in. Yes, no one has moved in. There we go. Now those houses are occupied. Alright, we have a fisherman and a child. What house he came from, and here we have another fisherman and a child. These single parents, I guess. Alright. Okay, we have 6 students now. That's good. We need those workers. Ah, we're getting some kiddos. 3 children. Bing, bing, bing. Good. Alright, new house is now online. Alright, I'm going to drop these builders back down to 0. And we are going to get our vendor and our trader and our forester back. Now, right now we're running at no laborers, but I'm going to monitor things closely here. There we go. Alright, let's pause that. We just picked up a laborer. Someone became an adult. That's good. Our teen just became a laborer, and our teen already has a house with a 13-year-old partner, which I assume is going to be our teen's wife. Alright, so, now that we have a new laborer, I think we should get another crop field online. I've been talking about orchards, but I think we'd better supplement first with crops, and the reason why is orchards don't produce right away. They take a long time to produce. The trees have to mature. Then they'll produce after a while. So let's go ahead and create a crop field. And we have a new crop. We have squash. We picked up the seeds. So I recommend that this be a squash field. Now, and that means our team has to become a farmer. So we'll queue up another farmer. I don't know if anyone will plant that this year. It's already summer. They may plant it. We'll see. Let's see if someone plants that. Now, it may be too late in the season, so maybe that's not going to get planted. Okay, so what happened? Okay, so Marvid the herbalist passed away. No one was available to replace Marvid, which means we're now down to zero herbalists. So I'm going to knock my trader back down and reassign my trader as an herbalist. We're just going to manage this situation. There are still geriatric people in the population who are going to pass on. This is all looking very good. Okay, a child became a student, so we have 6 students queued up. And hopefully, in the following year, we'll have enough workers that we can lay out the orchard. We'll need the orchard first, because it's going to take a while for that orchard to produce. Okay, it's now summer of the year 20, and what you might have noticed is that the squash field is already, almost half empty. This field over here has got 2 farmers working in it. The cabbage field over here is still being tilled. So why is that? That's one of the things about acquiring different kinds of seeds. Why would you bother? The reason why you would bother is that different kinds of crops mature in different periods of time. One thing that I noticed, for example, is peppers. If you get peppers, they mature fairly quickly, and they get harvested fairly quickly. So why would you care? Well, it helps to smooth out your food situation. Remember that, you know, after harvest, you're now eating whatever it is you harvested. You're going to be eating it. You're going to be eating it in spring while you're replanting. You're going to be eating it in late spring and summer while you're taking care of the crops that you planted. And you want it to last you all the way to autumn when you harvest again. So if you can get some crops that mature early, and some crops that mature after a medium amount of time, and some crops that mature very, very late, then it means you have influx of food all throughout the growing season, as opposed to just all at the end. Cabbages and potatoes go almost to the end. Squash will come a little bit sooner. If we could find something like peppers, then we could, you know, get something that comes out even sooner. So it allows you to stagger your harvesting and smooth out your food production. So this is working out okay. Let's just take a look at the food graph. So that slight downward trend now looks like it's on a very gentle uptick, which is good. That's fine. We want a nice gentle uptick. The trend looks a little better with the addition of this new field. I've also been looking at our citizen overview, and as you can see, our population is 94% educated. Now, just a few years ago, they were only 58% educated. And the reason for that great uptick is not because we've made some massive inroads in education. All of the old uneducated people have been dying off. That's one way for your citizenry to get smarter. But that means that older people who were doing jobs perhaps less efficiently have been replaced by younger people who are better educated and will hopefully do them more efficiently. We're currently running at 1 laborer right now because I've been rotating additional laborers into jobs. So for example, Deloradin became a laborer and then he had to replace a gatherer. We did pick up 1 more child. So we are now at 31 adults, 5 students. I wish those students would become adults. With 5 more people, we could definitely get a couple orchards online and start looking at a tavern. The other thing to keep in mind is we do have disasters turned on. And one of the disasters is disease. There could be an outbreak of some sort of disease. The more population we have, the higher the risk of that becomes. And that means that at some point we're going to have to build a hospital. That's only going to take one worker, but it is going to take a lot of stone to build. And the other thing about a hospital is you need to build it away from the community. Like if you put the hospital right here next to the school, people who walk past the hospital have a risk of getting ill if there are sick people in the hospital. So generally the idea is you find some place out of the way, like across the river here, and you put your hospital there. You know, some place where there isn't going to be a lot of foot traffic, where you're not anticipating lots and lots of people pouring over this bridge. Now you do have to think about future expansion. If we decide to build over here some point, maybe put a tunnel under this hill and build a second community over here, then we're not going to want our hospital right on the main thoroughfare that goes over there. So we'll have to find a place that's out of the way, that we don't anticipate a lot of people going to. Like maybe over here, behind this hill. Like if we put the hospital here, we find a way to finagle this road around and stick the hospital over here at a sort of a cul-de-sac at the end of the road. Then it's out of the way, and hopefully our citizenry won't be wandering over here to hang out. Now, people do visit their sick relatives in the hospital. That goes without saying. So illnesses can still spread. So far, we haven't really seen any outbreaks of disease. The herbalist has been able to handle it all. But I think we're going to have to deal with it fairly soon. Well, that was prescient. We've had an outbreak of dysentery. I was afraid that was going to happen, and it's happened. So one of our farmers, he's 34, has dysentery. We don't have a hospital, so that's a real problem. So I have rejuggled the professions around. I took the vendor offline and the trader offline and one of the foresters offline. And right now, that gave us a total of 5 laborers. I've reassigned 2 as builders and came over here and asked them to build the hospital here. Once it's built, we can assign someone as a physician. But while we're waiting for that to happen, our sick little farmer here is going to be wandering around infecting the community. Sigh. Oh well, we knew we were at risk for it. Hopefully this will catch it in time. So let's kick things off here. Alright, now, as this farmer wanders around, he could make other people sick. If people get near him. I guess he's in his house. Oh, we just picked up someone else who's sick. This person here. Exit. It says, Carlin the farmer is visiting the doctor. Is our doctor online? No. Not yet. And this is Ward, who's a 7-year-old child, and it says he's visiting the doctor, by which I think they mean the herbalist, or maybe they're waiting because they know the doctor is being built here. All right, we are picking up lots of children. If you notice, we have 14 children now. This is great. It does mean we're going to have a real need to increase our food production, but as workers come online, we'll be able to do that, if we didn't have to worry about everybody getting sick. So hopefully this will get built very, very quickly. What I've done is I've placed it at the end of sort of a dead-end road behind this stockpile, behind a hill. There are no other destinations over here. So the only people who are going to go over there, hopefully, are the people who are going there to visit sick relatives. So as soon as we get that built, we're going to kick one of our laborers into the role of physician. And hopefully we can nip this illness in the bud. We have nomads. Now we have nomads. All right, let's quickly go over here. There are 5 nomads requesting citizenship. Do we want to allow them to become citizens of Bincotton Bridge? We'll have to find houses for them all. And we're in the middle of managing an outbreak. We're up to six sick people. I think we're going to deny these nomads. One might argue, well, it would be helpful to have the helping hand when you have ill citizens, but you know what? I don't want to bring in those uneducated people right now. If the population was healthier, I would bring them in. Another thing I've been watching is the level of firewood. It's getting pretty low in the wintertime now. It's because there are so many houses. They all have to be supplied with firewood, which means, really, we're going to need another woodcutter to support this many houses. Okay, we're at 5 people with dysentery. Back up to 6. If we could get this built, that'd be great there, Build-A-Man. There we go. That should help out. Come on, finish. Finish the job. Oh good, the builder is sick. Wonderful. Ever is visiting the doctor. You are you? Okay, good. Alright, so let's knock the builders back down to 0, and we will need to assign a physician. There we go. Now all the sick people are going in there. Now, we're down to 3 sick people, so the dysentery outbreak wasn't all that bad, thankfully, but it needed to be dealt with. Now, the problem is that there will be people visiting these people. They may be also become sick, but at least it's not down here in the center of town where everybody hangs around. It's way over here, out of the way. There goes another sick person. The other problem is that sometimes people will leave the doctors before they're well. They start feeling a little better, and they say, I'm going back to work. And off they go, and they make more people sick. So, but that definitely needed to be done. Let's kick one of our laborers into the trading post, and then let's see what this trader wants. He is the resource merchant, and he has firewood. Well, it would be really good to get firewood, but the resource merchant won't take anything that we have. He probably would take ale. We don't have any ale. And I don't want to trade away any stone or iron to get that firewood, so he might take leather. We do have quite a bit of it. Let's put some leather in here. Let our trader go off and get the leather. We do have a trader assigned now. There we go. Okay, so now I have 6 leather. So yes, he will take leather. All right. We picked up another laborer. This is good. That's what we want to see. We want to see those laborers go up. Nobody is sick. That's good. So, whew. Man, I wasn't kidding when I said we were going to need a doctor soon. Alright, so right now we have 10 leather. If we gave him 10 leather, we could pick up 25 firewood. Yeah, 25, as in 25. Now 2 of the 5 after it. It's not much. Now we have 29 leather, 50 leather. Okay, so 50 was 500. Alright, so how much firewood can we get for that? We're up to 415 firewood, which is good, but I want to see it. Okay, and dismiss. Okay, good. So now our merchant will bring, our trader will bring that firewood back, and we've got a little influx of firewood, so maybe we don't need another woodcutter this year. That would be good. I think we're going to bring 2 orchards online. 2 apple orchards, 7x7 orchards. That will take us down to 1 laborer. And we'll have to go up to 10 farmers. And then when we get some more laborers, which we hopefully will do, then we'll make a tavern. And then we'll set our trader to trade ale. And hopefully we'll be able to finagle all that without a major disaster striking the village. There are 2 little apple orchards. Little trees growing. Little farmers tending them. Uh-oh, we lost a gatherer. Okay, I guess we'll take the trader offline and make a gatherer out of him. Yeah, I wasn't imagining it. I'm looking at the firewood here. And as you can imagine, firewood ticks up and down, up and down, up and down. But as you can see, with each of the passing winters in the recent years, the firewood's been dropping lower and lower and lower. It's because of the increased number of houses, the increased citizenry. I mean, let's face it, we were at about, oh, I don't know, 42 people a little while ago, and now we're pushing 50. The population is 54 now. So we've added about 20% to our population in this episode. And that's really starting to impact firewood. So as much as I really want to get a tavern online, I think we're going to have to make a woodcutter. It just takes more, it takes a higher precedence. We need more people cutting wood. And we need to raise our reserve levels as well. Actually, let's go to 600 on both. Let's get these guys busy. And God, I really want to get that tavern going, but I think we're going to have to make the woodcutter. So, much as I would like to do that, we need another woodcutter. So I think we'll put the woodcutter there. And we're going to need to turn these laborers into builders. Good, we just picked up another laborer. Numbers are looking good up here. 9 students, 9 kids, 10 kids. Fine, that's fine. Alright, so now we have a new woodcutter. Let us take our builders back down to 0, and let's throw another woodcutter on the fire. while you were away, another merchant came, and he was a general goods merchant, and he had cherry tree seeds. And we did have enough goods in here to trade for the cherry tree seeds. And these goods are looking a little low now. Oh, our trader's bringing them in now. Yeah, he's bringing them in now. So, there we go. Every winter, I have been jockeying jobs around and sending people over here. There's still stuff waiting here to be gathered. Some iron here. Sending people over here to gather stuff. We haven't had a lot of laborers, so it's been difficult. The other thing about farmers, I've been getting very used to unassigning them in the winter. Orchard farmers have to work year-round. Okay. Ah! I see apples. That might be a good sign. What's the production on this? No production yet. This might be the first season that we actually produce some fruit on these trees. That would be nice. We're in early summer of the year 23, so I think it's been a couple years since we made these apple orchards. So hopefully, this year, they'll produce some fruit. Okay, hopefully we won't get any parasites killing our apple trees. Actually, on parasites, let's talk about that a little bit. I generally would not like to put two orchards right next to each other the same kind of plant because of the possibility of parasites. That's one of the disasters that can strike. But at the time, all we had were apple seeds. Now I have cherry seeds as well, but I don't feel like tearing down an orchard to put cherry seeds in, so we'll let it go. If an orchard gets infested with parasites, you have to cut the trees down. It's the only way to stop the infestation. So we'll let it go like this, and someday when one of them becomes infested, we'll chop it down and we'll replace it with cherry trees, and then we'll have two different species, and we won't have to worry as much about it spreading. the other thing is, you may have noticed that I make my fields 7x7. 7x7 is the largest that can be worked by one farmer. So if you create a field that's double size, like this one, 7x14, you need two farmers. Anything that's 7x7 or smaller will only take one. So it's a good way to organize and to think about, you know, when I lay this out, how many farmers am I going to need? If it's a 16x16 square with 4 7x7 fields in it, then I need 4 different farmers to work those 4 different fields. That's why I'm choosing those sizes, and the orchards are also sized the same. It's 2 7x7 orchards. Even though they're the same plant, at least if one of them gets infested, they aren't automatically both infested, right? Infestation happens at the orchard level, so if I had done this as one orchard, it would have been the same. It would take two farmers to manage, and it would produce the same amount of fruit, but when an infestation strikes, I would have to cut all of the trees down as opposed to just half of them. So that was the reason for doing that. Oh, my goodness, I can really talk, can I? Let's hope that these guys are producing apples now. Okay, so let's check production. It's not saying anything for the current season. And we're in autumn. It may be one, it may be the presence of apples being painted on here may just be artwork. And it would appear that it's artwork. These apples are not ready to produce yet, so. Those little pictures of apples on there were just to let you know that they were apple trees. They're not actually producing apples yet. And there's no reason to build a tavern until they are producing apples. So, let's let this town grow a little bit, and I will get back to you when we have some apples. Nice, check that out. Storage, 414 apples in the inventory in our community. And let's check the production. Yep, this produced 388 apples. This produced 387 apples. So we produced about 800 apples, of which 400 are in storage, which means that 400 probably disappeared into the homes in our community, people grabbing fresh apples. Let's just check inventory. No apples there. Yep, apples here. Yep. The people who live in this house grab some of those apples. So, I think now that we have apples, we can get a tavern going. So let us... We also started to reach capacity on our storage of produced goods, so I went to the trader and I upped the limits dramatically on corn, venison... Excuse me, corn. Potatoes, venison, and cabbage. I keep thinking of my own one-player game that I run separately than this one. In that one, I have a lot of corn. I also added one more house. As you can see, there were two young people to get right in there, so that's good. So yeah, so let's get that tavern online. We'll get him producing ale. We'll tell the trader to stock the ale. One of the things you can't do in this game, it's a little strange, is you can't set inventory requirements on any item you don't have. So for example, we're going to produce ale, but right now we don't have any. And because we don't have any, we can't set an inventory limit. For example, we could make steel tools if we really wanted to. We don't have any, so I can't set an inventory limit on steel tools. So if you're in a position where you're like, oh yeah, and I'm going to have apples soon, I'm going to trade the apples or something, and you come here and you find out, hey, I can't, don't panic. You just have to wait until you have some of those items in your inventory. We have 6 laborers available right now, so that's good. We're swimming in laborers, which is a good place to be. So I think that we can create a tavern. And the next thing that we will probably look at creating is a church. That'll be in the next episode. And we're also going to have to start looking at a mine and a quarry because we are running out of ground resources in the vicinity of this community. But let's get a tavern online. Flip that around, and we're going to put it right there, snug up against those trees, like that. And I will rejoin you when that tavern is built. Ah, okay, that happened a lot more quickly than I thought it would. We got our tavern built, so let's assign a brewer to the tavern. Let's pause the game here. Okay, so our alcohol limit's currently set to 500. Sounds great. He's already assuming that we're going to make it out of apple. You can tell him to make it out of berries if you want. Remember, you have berries because you have a gatherer. Everything else that you make it out of comes from trees, with the exception of wheat. You can make ale from wheat, of course, but we're not growing any wheat in this community. So we're going to tell him to make apple ale. Nothing in storage. Okay, so he is using the apples, and he hasn't yet made the ale, but he soon will. So as long as we now have it in our inventory, we should be able to go here and start stockpiling ale here. So let's stockpile 500 ale, which hopefully will mean that just about everything he makes will immediately be grabbed and put in here. And that will give us something more valuable to trade with that I think, not certain actually, I think we can trade ale to resource merchants, and I think we can trade it to livestock merchants. We'll have to wait and see. And if that doesn't work out, we'll come up with a new plan. So I want to thank you for joining me today for the latest episode of Bincotton Bridge. We had a real rough patch last episode, but this episode's been good. Next episode, we'll make a church and possibly some additional crops. And we'll worry about that then. Anyway, thanks for coming, and I hope you come back next time. Take care now. Bye-bye.